Again, today I will start a bit on the with the transparencies and then switch to the blackboard. So just to recapitulate, yesterday I one of the reasons why we are continuing to obsess with black holes is that this is a very universal and extremely stringent constraint that any phase of the theory that admits any black hole, we should be able to interpret it as an ensemble of quantum states. And if you somehow develop methods, I mean the goal is to develop methods to really study the quantum entropy of black holes, then if you can compute it, then it can provide us with an infrared window into the ultraviolet structure of the theory. And in particular, the finite size corrections to the quantum entropy give us very precise quantitative information about the UV. So that's the motivation. And basically, the question that I started to address yesterday was that what is the exact quantum generalization of the Bekenstein-Hawking formula in a manner that generalizes, incorporates Walsh generalization, but can also incorporate non-local quantum effects which come from. So basically, this area formula, this comes from the Einstein-Hilbert action. Corrections like that, basically it's a derivative expansion, you can think about it. So large area means the curvatures are small, radius of curvature is large. So these are sort of power loss, I mean higher derivative terms in the action. So this is like R, this could come from the R square term, this could come from which these terms come from integrating out massive fields, and this could come from integrating out massless fields, and there could also be non-perturbative corrections. So can we somehow give a definition which captures all of this and develop methods to compute them? That's the goal. And the very important constraint on this is that these all these very random looking infinite number of corrections should somehow conjure to add up. When you exponentiate this quantity, you should get an integer. And that's the requirement that is extremely stringent, which tells you that all these coefficients have to somehow be precisely right. And it is because of that that string theory is really something very rigid, and you cannot, for example, if you change the coefficient of the R square term in the effective action of string theory, C2 will change. If you are just dealing with some non-renormalizable theory, you could put whatever value of C2 that you want. But if you demand that, sorry, maybe I should put it lower down. I think it's too close. Okay, so can you hear me? So if you demand that this, sorry, what am I going? If you demand that this has to be an integer, then you are not at liberty to adjust these coefficients. And in fact, string theory gives you some very precise coefficients. And that's the power of string theory. Because of that, the subleading corrections which come, all these higher order corrections, depend sensitively on which compactification we are using. And that's why we get a window into the ultraviolet structure of the theory. Something got deleted, I don't know how. Okay, ADS CFT course. Sorry, question? Yeah, you don't know, a priori. So it should strike you as a bit of a magic. But so string theory really knows. So we will consider an example where using localization, we can get all these individual coefficients in precisely the right way, which at each order you don't know that it's going to add up to an integer. But when you add them all up, you get an integer. So yesterday we started out doing ADS CFT because the near horizon of an extremal charged black hole, which is what we are interested in, a BPS black hole in four dimensions, is ADS2 cross S2. If it is magnetically charged, then that S2 has some magnetic flux. So basically we can pretty much focus on the ADS2 regarding, so basically think of string theory compactified on some, say, six torus, so you have four-dimensional theory. And then you compactify further on an S2. So you regard, this is like a eight-dimensional dimensional reduction from 10 dimensions to ADS2. And all the information about the black hole, the magnetic charges, etc., is encoded in the fluxes along the S2. And the information about various terms in the effective action depend on the fact that you are, have a 6 torus or some Calabria manifold or K3 cross T2. Depending on what compactification you're using, you'll get different low energy theories, different values for these coefficients C2, etc., and also different quantum degeneracies for black holes. And they all have to match to be consistent with each other. So quantum entropy, as I said, we started to define this. So what I'm going to do today is that I'm just, again, once again, going to give you a little bit of a global view and then go back to this definition of quantum entropy, which we'll finish today. But this I will do to, at the end of my talk. So basically, I started out by telling you that the quantum entropy can be defined as a functional integral in ADS2 over all string fields with appropriate boundary conditions, operator insertions, and a renormalization procedure. And for large charges, the logarithm will reduce to the Bekenstein-Hawking Wall formula. So yesterday, good question. So if you have a classical black hole, then it will be precisely ADS2. But exactly, we will very soon move away from classical black hole because we want to allow random quantum fluctuations. So when we start to define the quantum theory, the quantum definition of entropy, you only want asymptotically ADS. But to begin with, the classical black hole will be exactly ADS. Because if you take the near horizon of a rational Nostrum black hole, it is exactly ADS. Any other question? No, so what we want to study, you want to study the near horizon of a black hole. And that we know in the Euclidean continuation is the ADS space, okay? Classically. However, quantum mechanically, you know that the metric can fluctuate. Quantum mechanically, even the metric can fluctuate, right? Or various gauge fields which you think were held to some value, they can fluctuate. But what we want to do is that we want to hold them fixed at infinity to be ADS and allow them random fluctuations inside. And that is what we are going to take to be the... So these are all quantum fluctuations. If you take the classical limit, it will be exactly ADS. But the quantum fluctuations don't have to necessarily be ADS because the metric itself will be fluctuating. Sorry? Yeah. No, so what we're going to do is that we're going to define a path integral in this ADS space. Yeah, let's just take a scalar field. So I can take a define a path integral like that, but now I have to specify the boundary condition on this scalar field. That I take to be ADS, meaning phi goes to phi star. Some fixed value, which is what is called the attractor value of that scalar field, which depends on the charges of the black hole. So you hold the scalar field to be fixed. It's like a Dirichlet boundary condition on this disk. And then I do this quantum functional integral. That's my prescription. Now, when I do this quantum functional integral, I will get non-local terms, but they are all incorporated in this path integral. So I don't have to think about an effective action. I just think of a path integral with some fixed boundary conditions. So the non-local effects will come after performing the path integral. Excuse me.
This you are drawing at ADS2.
Yeah, so this is artist impression of ADS2. This is Euclidean ADS2, which is a disk with this metric that we wrote down yesterday. And we said that we have to put a cutoff at R0, because otherwise the volume of the space is infinite. And there are various divergences. And we have to basically learn how to deal with those divergences. Because divergences in the bulk, we know, correspond to ultraviolet divergence in the boundary theory. This is the general holographic renormalization procedure. That if you, even if Yang-Mills theory, n equal to 4 Yang-Mills theory, there are divergences, you need to add local counter terms in the boundary theory. We have the freedom to add local counter terms. And you have to define the renormalization procedure so that you obtain finite answers. So that's what we're going to try to do, that we're trying to define a finite functional integral such that we remove this infrared divergence appropriately, correctly. So is that clear? So this is what we're going to do. And this path integral of all the, so by phi, I really mean all fields of string field theory. So I just have some abstract path integral like that, including all these infinite fields of string theory. And this I'm going to call W of Q. Because the boundary condition on the fields depends, and it can also depend on the magnetic charges, which are fluxes. So I'll just call it capital Q, let's say. Capital Q is so we define W of Q as this path integral of, we want to define, I'm going to give you a more precise definition, that's part of the talk, how to define this path integral. And then tomorrow we're going to evaluate that path integral. But before giving you all the details, because the evaluation of the path integral is actually technically, is very demanding, because you require all these fancy methods of localization, then there are all kinds of non-perturbative effects. It's something of a, really a surprise that you can actually do those things precisely and exactly and get an integer out. It's really a surprise, actually. It's, and I don't think I can really describe all the details of that computation in one lecture. But what I'm going to do is that I want to just give you a flavor, an understanding of what we're trying to do, and so that tomorrow you can appreciate what, when we actually do the, try to do the calculation. So this is our comparison that we had. So we're going to define some W of Q as a path integral, which I will tell you today how to define. That describes a near horizon geometry of a black hole with some charge vector Q. And that exponential logarithm of that we interpret as the quantum entropy. And this is the ADS2 side of things, which involves a space-time geometry in the bulk. And this is the quantum generalization of Bekenstein-Hawking. On the right-hand side, the black hole, if you had supposed a 10-dimensional theory, is going to be some brains wrapping the internal T6, for example. You could have some D1, D5 system and all kinds of complicated junk. And that's going to have some very specific degeneracy that we're going to compute. That's just a simple counting of states of the quantum Hilbert space of string theory. And that we typically do at some weak coupling. And then again, the question arises, the couple of questions that arose in yesterday's discussion is that typically these computations, you can calculate only an index, which is number of bosons minus number of fermions, because these are some topological computations. And as we said, Boltzmann never knew about any index. So why does it have anything to do with the black hole entropy? So we have to explain that the index that you're going to compute is actually the degeneracy that you're interested in, that Boltzmann is interested in. And that's the CFT1 side of thing, which is a well-defined Hilbert space. And the fact that it is an index is really important, because that's what allows you to analytically continue from weak coupling, where you compute the results, to strong coupling where the black hole exists. Secondly, we have to also decide whether we have a working with a microcanonical ensemble or a canonical ensemble. So that also, as we said yesterday, comes out of the consideration. And what is new? So black holes have been around, I mean, this topic has been around in holography for 20 years. So what is new in this, what I'm going to describe tomorrow and today, is that our focus will be on a finite size effects or finite charge corrections to the black hole entropy, which, unlike the leading Bekenstein-Hawking formula, depends on whether you have an internal T6 or internal Calabi-Yau or what kind of a deep brain, which are really ultraviolet properties of the theory. Because if you have some wrapped deep brain in Calabi-Yau, its mass is much bigger compared to the ultraviolet cutoff that you're putting, which is a string scale. So by doing a computation, by using these fields, integrating out these fields at energies below the string scale, you are going to get information about the ultraviolet structure of the theory. So how to evaluate it? So this is now I'm going to describe just in a very simple example, just so that you have something to something really concrete to hang on to. So D of Q, as we say, is the number of bound state of a brain system. Now, this is actually, in general, an extremely difficult dynamical problem. I mean, we are used to, in string theory, using deep brain technology to do it. But to do it generically for a generic Calabi-Yau in n equal to 2 theories has not yet been solved to this completely. One can still... So we are going to restrict ourselves to simpler situations with more supersymmetry, where you can actually... Even there, the problem is hard enough. But you can actually get an answer out of the procedure, following D brains and so on. And W of Q, as we say, is given by a formal functional integral. And we have to see, okay, it's a functional integral over infinite number of fields, but what can you do with it? And can we really push it further and get some numbers out of it? And a lot of progress has been made in simple models in these computations, I mean, on different fronts. So D of Q has been computed in a lot of different models. W of Q is now evaluated. So now what we're going to do is that we want to put this formalism to test. And we want to actually do some calculations rather than just have an abstract apparatus. So now D of Q should be some number, right? Because after all, we claim that we know quantum string theory. So if you tell me the charges of a black hole, you should tell me how many states correspond to that. And that calculation is D of Q. Now that depends on which Calabi-Yau compactification you're considering. Because you have a four-dimensional space-time and a charged black hole. But the charges of the black hole basically come from wrapped brains in some internal manifold. So how the brains are wrapped and which manifold they are wrapped in, that is the ultraviolet information that you have to provide to be able to compute D of Q. No, because you really need to know, you cannot get the integer out, right, just by knowing the topology. You have to know how the brain is intersecting with it. If it is a self-intersecting brain, whether you have D5 brains, some number of D1 brains, or you have all D3 brains, you can have all kinds of possibilities, right? And so depending on that, the black hole will have different charges. But just specifying the charges doesn't tell you, for example, how the brains are intersecting or how many times they're intersecting and things like that. So that information is what is required to compute D of Q. Now, this problem, as I said, for n equal to 8 and n equal to 4 supersymmetric black holes, this problem has essentially been solved. So n equal to 8 means that you just take type 2 string theory compactified on T6. So type 2 on and on K3 cross T2 and various orbifolds of it, which preserves supersymmetry. So this has n equal to 8 supersymmetry into d equal to 4 dimensions. Okay, this D is not that D, huh? I mean, that's obvious, but. And in all these examples, D generous is given in terms of Fourier coefficients of modular forms. So modular forms of various kinds, you know, some depending on the complexity of the, they can be simple modular forms, or they can be what are called Jacobi forms, or they can be Siegel modular forms, they are Mach modular forms, weak Jacobi forms. So, but basically they are modular, and it's related to, the modularity is related to the fact that these black holes are related to a black string. And a good example to keep in mind is the Strominger-Wafer black hole, that you have a D1, D5P system. So this was in 5 dimensions. We are in 4 dimensions, but it's very similar. So in the Strominger Wafa black hole, you had a D1 brain wrapping some circle. So they had a T5 instead of T6. And you had some D1 brain wrapping a circle and a D5 brain wrapping the T5. And that's what gave rise to a black string. And then you could send in some momentum along the black string. But a black string, so a black hole is kind of an excitation of a black string. And the near horizon of this is ADS2. And the near horizon of this is ADS3. But ADS3 is like a cylinder, solid cylinder. So ADS2 was a disk, whereas ADS3 is a cylinder. And if you identify the boundary of the ADS3, then the boundary of ADS3 is a conformal torus, because ADS3 is conformal with some tau parameter. And diffeomorphism of this torus is a symmetry of the theory. So that's the SL2Z global diffeomorphisms, which is just relabeling of the torus by, if you have a lattice, you can relabel them is what gives rise to the modular symmetry. So that's the origin of that modular symmetry. And that's because you have a CFT. ADS3 is dual to a CFT. And you know that partition functions of CFT are typically modular forms. So that's, of course, that's not entirely how they actually come in the computations, but that's one of the physical reasons why you can expect modularity to be present in this problem. So it's actually quite subtle. It turns out when you have wall crossing and so on, this modularity is very tricky. But just so that you have something to keep in mind, that this modular symmetry is not something that is falling from the sky. Yes, it's a very good question. And OK, so we have, that would be the next obvious thing to do. And it's actually a very interesting problem to be able to do a path integral in ADS3. But there are technical difficulties because of which it has not been completed. But I think that's certainly a very interesting problem to do. I mean, we have some partial results in that direction, but we have not.
But there can also be black holes which do not have this ADS underlying
it. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. Another reason is that, yeah, so the ADS2, so I should make a comment that the ADS2 formalism is in a way more fundamental. You could take it as being more fundamental if you're interested in the black hole problem, because not all ADS2 need arise as excitations of a black string. So therefore, there is a reason to try to develop the ADS2 formalism on its own. Moreover, as we said, you end up getting an integer, meaning you land up naturally in a microcanonical ensemble in ADS2. So it's a, you basically get, okay, it depends, that's a matter of taste, but okay, it's a bit simpler because of that. Whereas in ADS3, you'll get a modular form rather than a Fourier coefficient of a modular form. Yeah, I think one can make examples in, I don't know, in five dimensions there are examples where, yeah, there are, one can quite easily make, right? It doesn't have to necessarily come from a black string. Like if you have some, right, in five dimensions, you can, there are examples, I think Wafa had some examples, right? I mean, there's, pure D-brain system. Yeah, pure intersecting D-brain system. They're more complicated to get your hands on because, but they exist in string theory. And, any other question? Yeah. So but because we are, that's a good question. So again, because we are interested in low energy excitations of this black string, because we are interested in a supersymmetric black hole, we can take the near horizon limit. And therefore, the black hole actually exists because it's a supersymmetric excitation. You could imagine very wild excitations of the string, which are have nothing to do with the black hole, but the supersymmetric black holes are contained in the ADS3. So computing W of Q, on the other hand, is a really much more complicated, even more complicated, because you have to integrate out all these. So I will just go, I'm going to tell you how I'm going to approach this problem, because if you try to set this up as a functional integral in string field theory, then as we said, we really don't have methods in string field theory. And Ashok can correct me, but I think it's true. That in closed string field theory, to really do this, it would be again an interesting possibility. Maybe one can try to do a computation in closed string field theory directly. But in the absence of such a formalism, what one can imagine doing is that you integrate out all the massive string modes to get a Wilsonian effective action for the massless field. So at least you reduce your path integral from infinite number of fields to just massless fields. But the price that you pay is that this will be a very complicated action. So this will be Wilsonian action. And therefore, it will have an infinite number of terms, r plus r square plus, as I said, r box r and so on. But then, okay, that's a bit of a simplification, but that one still needs to make sense of a formal path integral of supergravity fields. And so you should, if you have any experience with path integrals, it tells you that you should, trying to use this to do explicit computation is fraught with danger. So you should proceed very carefully and keep your wits about it. But what we're going to do is that following localization and following answers that we know from this side, you can sort of just follow your nose and see what the theory gives you. And you come actually very, very close to the answer. I mean, so there are still some issues that have to be completely ironed out. But I think there is no doubt in my mind that in the coming year or two, we will have a full understanding of W of Q, at least in some simple examples. And what makes it possible is this method of localization in supergravity. So let me just briefly tell you what is localization. So I started at not plenty of time, right? Yeah. I started late. So. Okay. That's what I was angling for. Okay, so localization is a general method supersymmetric path integrals. And the idea is that suppose you have a path integral, some complicated path integral with bosons and fermions. Then it basically uses the fact that Grassmann integration an integration over a Grassmann variable over theta. Theta is a Grassmann variable. That d theta is 0. So now imagine, and suppose you have some operator inserted here. So the intuitive idea, and I will explain this in more detail. So it's basically this very simple looking observation, that using this observation, you want to evaluate this path integral. Our path integral is going to look like that, w. And the idea is that it's an infinite dimensional integral. But what happens is that if this everything is supersymmetric, which means everything is invariant under some translations, so if the action and the operator that you're inserting and the measure is invariant under Q, then basically we can change variables, and just like we do in Fadir Popov, that you go, there are orbits, your field space has orbits of this del by del theta. So you can take this path integral and write it as d theta times something else, d phi prime, d psi prime. So theta is an integration along this variable. And so these are the orbits of this charge q. These are q orbits. And this is the manifold that is of phi prime and psi prime. Okay, that's the idea. You split this measure in this. But since everything is invariant under theta, they don't depend on theta. So this should be 0. If you could do this everywhere, then this would be 0. But generically, what will happen is that q will have fixed points. So for example, q might have a fixed point here. In that case, the whole path integral that you want to do localizes. So path integral localizes. So let's call that q fixed manifold, some manifold sigma. So you just need to evaluate e to the s on that submanifold sigma, and the operator on that submanifold sigma. But you also, you can have one loop, so there are, how to do this precisely, there can be one loop determinant corrections that you have to take into account. But other than that, you basically expect that the path integral collapses q fixed point, which can be a manifold, it doesn't have to be a point. So when I write down as a sum, it could be of integral. But it's still a smaller integral than the original integral that you were doing. And in fact, if you're lucky, in some cases, the integral is just finite dimensional. And if you're really lucky, which can happen, because even a finite dimensional integral, as you know, we cannot always do. I mean, many times I cannot do not just a single integral. So finite dimensional integral is also not easy to do. But if you're really lucky, then you can even do this explicitly. No, so theta is, so you do an expansion of phi. So basically, like in, if you are familiar with quantization of Yang-Mills theory, right, you have some path integral, it's like a Fadir Popov procedure, that if you have a gauge field, and this gauge field is invariant under some symmetry, then what you do is that you take out the orbit of that gauge group, and take the slice which is orthogonal to that. And that separation you can do using Fadir Popov procedure. Now here, that symmetry is not a gauge symmetry, it's some symmetry. But I can always take the field space and take do the mode expansion of the fields in terms of mode that are, I can do the Fadir Popov procedure, basically, on that manifold. Right? So this is in field space. These are orbits of Q. So Q can act on phi and Q can act on psi. Right? And then you look for the orbit. So take given any phi, you can see where are the images of that phi under q. That's the orbit. And then you try to slice the entire path integral in terms of this division. And in this is very similar to what you do in gauge theory. In gauge theory, then what you do is you mod out by the volume of the, you forget about the integration, right? In gauge theory, you basically do this some kind of dg times the rest of the things. And this you drop using gauge invariance. Here, we are not going to drop it. We are going to say that that's what gives you zero. But the procedure is very similar to Fourier Popov procedure. Yeah, it's just a del by del theta. No, it's not, it's, yeah. So Q squares to something which is space-time. So square of Q will be a translation in real space-time. It's a compact generator, it will. I will come to the more details in tomorrow. Sorry? No, no, so therefore, from each orbit, separately I'll get zero. I'll get 0, 0, 0, 0 here. The procedure can only fail when it's a fixed point of Q, because there could be, there's a potential problem, because there, you're not moving anywhere, right? There is no integration to be done. So therefore, the whole, you cannot receive any contribution from anywhere else. If at all, you could receive contributions from the fixed points of Q. How to implement it precisely is, it requires a little bit of more machinery, which I will describe tomorrow. And this method has been extremely powerful. I mean, lots of very important results in quantum field theory were obtained using this localization methods. For example, in the ABJM theory, that ADS CFT, that to say that the CFT goes as n to the 3/2, right? I mean, from the gauge theory side, so for example, just to give an example. So in QFT, localization methods have been used extensively. Starting with the work of Witten, actually, who brought this into the physics literature. So even in quantum mechanics and QFT, it's a very rich subject, actually. In quantum mechanics, they lead to all kinds of index theorems, proofs of index theorems, because everything is you're evaluating some supersymmetric path integral of a supersymmetric quantum mechanics system, which you can again evaluate using localization. In QFT, some of the results are, for example, Chethan had a very important computation where he computed exactly Wilson line in n equal to in supersymmetric angles theory, n equal to 4 and n equal to 2 on S4. And there, what localization did was that it collapsed the path integral to a matrix integral. Which is some kind of a zero mode of this gauge field. I mean, basically, a mode of this gauge field, which is a single mode. So it's a, instead of doing an infinite dimensional functional integral in SUN gauge theory, you just have to do an n cross s n finite dimensional matrix integral. And which again, you can do explicitly in some cases. So QFT, Pestun, and then also results in, so I should just mention one or two results. So one is the result of Pestun, and the other result is in ADS4. CFT3, so this is an ADS5 CFT4, where you use the localization methods to compute something in the boundary conformal field theory, and then you can try to compare it with the bulk theory. Here, in fact, it was known that there is this famous n to the 3/2 growth of states that you get in ADS4. To reproduce it from the CFT3 computation, you had to do a strong coupling computation, and that you could only do explicitly. So this was some very nice results by various people. Marino and has a nice review on that. So the these methods have given us a kind of a tool to go where you could not go before. I mean, there was no way you could have computed n to the 3/2 in quantum field in the strongly coupled Chern-Simons theory without these methods. Similarly here, And one can view the, what I'm going to describe tomorrow as a kind of a beginning of a similar program in quantum gravity. So as far as I know, these localization results are first application of its kind in supergravity. So what we are trying to do is that not do the path integral is here, but you want to do the path integral here, in the bulk. So we are basically we are interested in analogous thing in ADS 2 cross CFT 2, CFT 1, but we are going to use localization to evaluate path integral of quantum gravity rather than and so that's why we can really obtain quantum information about the gravity, which are finite end corrections. This is this was another motivation that I had mentioned in my talks, that this can be viewed as an example of sort of quantum holography. By that I mean finite end so the quantum entropy that we are computing finite charge is just a special case of quantum holography of finite end. Now, because of that, because we are dealing with gravity, the rules are less clear, and there are all kinds of subtle issues that that are not yet completely settled. I mean, so it's, I would say that it's a kind of a evolving field. I think we have sufficiently now robust results that are that tell us that we are on the right track. But one can imagine that one can hope that in the coming years one can use these methods for more and more. Aspects of quantum gravity. For example, we already had some work in ADS 4 context. So instead of doing the path integral in CFT 3, you can try to do the path integral of ADS 4, and we have partial results there. So rules are less clear, and that's where comparison with boundary results is a very useful guide. And so one hopes that these methods can be developed further in the coming years, and much like localization in QFT, which sort of developed slowly over 20 years, and people were able to master more and more difficult problems. So that's, you can say, as a kind of a long-term outlook of this. So therefore, to guide our intuition and guide our computation, we need something to compare with. Otherwise, you are sort of lost in the in a violent sea kind of thing, because it's quantum gravity. And that's where having D of Q will really help us. So the question we address is W of Q is equal to D of Q. And we are really interested in methods to compute W of Q. But today now I will talk about computation of D of Q. So the simplest example is that many of you might have seen is a heterotic on some circle S1 on T6. So this is the simplest black hole, and you can consider that a fundamental string wrapping W times with n units of momentum. So winding and momentum state wrapping this circle. Quantized momentum, so momentum is n upon r and so on. And then there is a constraint that we know that n has to be equal to 1 minus nw. And we can just work out the partition function q to the n d of n. The degeneracy d of q depends only on duality invariance. Q square, which is nw. So basically, we can talk about just n and instead of computing n and w separately, we can just talk about the duality invariant. So the main result is that the degeneracies depend and the nice thing is that when you write down this partition function, this turns out to be a very beautiful mathematical function. Which of course we recognize very easily as coming from there are in heterotic string theory, the left moving number of, so you put the right movers in the ground state and heterotic string left moving things are 26 dimensional, but you have one time and the string is extending along the one direction. So you have 24 bosonic oscillators, which are the transverse degrees of freedom of the string. And those are the, you have to basically, the total energy in these oscillations is n. And so you can put the energy in different kinds of oscillations. And it's just basically, this is the partition function of 24 bosons, left moving bosons. That's what you get. But this has nice modular properties. And this is the famous Ramanujan function. It's called 1 upon delta tau. It's a modular form of, let me call this F tau. This is the modular form of weight 12. So what is the modular form? It's a holomorphic function F tau on the upper half complex plane. So this is our upper half complex plane. Imaginary tau is positive. And it's basically a very symmetric function. I mean, basically, it's symmetric under this A tau plus B divided by C tau plus D is basically symmetric up to this factor, where A, B, C, D, and K are integers. In our case, K is minus 12. And A, B, C, D satisfy this property that A, D minus B, C is 1. So it's an SL to Z matrix. And as I said, that SL to Z in many examples, in this example is a little harder to see, but most examples is related to a boundary SL to Z of the torus. Okay, it depends on what you mean by physical. Yeah, so this weight, for example, will determine the coefficient of the logarithmic term that we talked about yesterday. So the coefficient of the logarithmic terms comes from the integrating out massless loops. And the number of bosons minus fermions or whatever the number of degrees of freedom that you have. So this K is related to that. So that's one physical interpretation of that. But of course, so it is a physical quantity because it really captures the number of states of the system, and but whether it has so one of the manifestations will be in the logarithmic correction, for example. In fact, as we'll see, so it determines the what is the index of the, we will come in a moment. Now one can try to do a slightly more complicated problem, 1/8 BPS states in n equal to 8 theory. So instead of taking heterotic on T6, we can take type 2 on T6. And that's the system that I will focus on tomorrow. And you basically consider some complicated, it's a somewhat more complicated thing to describe, but it's basically a D5 brain wrapping, D1, D5P system, plus some topnet space, some KK monopole. So at least the D1, D5P system, you know, it's going to have target space T4. So if you have a D5 brain wrapping a T4, and some number of D1 brains on S1 that belong to this T6. So you basically have a D5 brain that is wrapping a T4, and some number of D1 brains sprinkled on it. And that gives rise to a kind of a string, effective string on the S1. And that effective string has rough, just like in our earlier problem, that effective string had 24 bosonic degrees of freedom. It has 4 fermionic and 4 bosonic. And those are basically come from oscillations of that string in this T4 direction. So the string is wrapping on some another circle. And it is bound to this T4, and the oscillations in the T4, roughly speaking, are the bosonic and the fermionic degrees of freedom. So again, the counting is very simple, and it gives rise to this theta function. So I can just, in fact, write it very explicitly. And then I will switch to the blackboard. So the theta 1, just to remind you, so I just want to tell you that these computations, after you have done them, the answers are very simple. The computation themselves are actually a bit, in this simpler examples are simple, but they can get complicated. But the answers are very simple to state. So this is a well-known Jacobi theta function. Where q is e to the 2 pi I tau, and y is some e to the 2 pi I z. And so this and eta is just q to the 1 upon 12, 1 upon 14, oh sorry, 1 upon 24. So this partition function that I wrote down, now it depends on two variables, tau and z. And it's basically a product of four, you can immediately identify it looks like this roughly. So you can immediately identify these are the four bosons and these are the four fermions, and the fermions are charged under this z, bosons are not. So you get this. Okay, so these computations always sort of are, in the end, we only know how to do free particles. So we try to reduce it to some free bosons and free fermions. Okay, but the main result is that now I can just do the Fourier expansion of this. Now I can define things just like in the earlier case, not in terms of q to the n, but I have two variables. But it turns out that the C of nr really depend on a single variable. I'll call it capital T. So the Fourier coefficients, meaning if you did the Fourier coefficients of this function, this you can put on a computer. You can just do it by hand, actually, right? These are just simple geometric things. And you work out the Fourier coefficient, what you will find is that whenever 4n minus r squared takes the same value, then cn nr take the same value. So you could have different values of n and r, but as long as 4n minus r squared is the same, c of nr is the same. So all the information about cnr is contained in a function of a single variable, c of delta. Okay, and that function I'm going to plot. And at the end of the day, when all the dust settles, just like in our previous problem, if you remember, the degeneracy of q was in the end just degeneracy of q square upon 2, which was a Fourier coefficient of this function 1 upon delta tau for our heterotic problem. In this case, d of delta, it's slightly more complicated object. It's minus 1 to the delta plus 1, this capital C of delta. So basically, given a charge, so now there's a complete algorithm, right? Given a charge, suppose I give you some charge. In fact, in this theory, you have 56 charges, you know. Half of them are electric, half of them are magnetic. So I give you some 56 integers. We just specify, calculate this quantity delta, which is q square p square minus q dot p square. Suppose that is some number 5. Then you just look at this function and look at the Fourier coefficient of c of delta. And if it is an odd integer, then this will minus 1 to the delta plus will be plus. So I'll just plot it a few examples for you. So the non-zero coefficients occur for delta is equal to 3, 4, 7, 8, 11, 12, 15. C of delta is 8 minus 12. So 3 is odd, 4 is even, like that. And C also alternates. Therefore, D is positive, as required. Now, if you did, this is the answer that you would have gotten if you were just doing Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. So the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, which is area upon 4, is basically pi square root of delta. If you calculated that, you can see that this is very way off compared to this integer. And our goal is to really get this number. And in fact, if you do the perturbative, if you resum all the perturbation theory, you actually get number which is very, very close. And some of the more recent work, which involves some really fancy number theory, Clusterman sums, which we were able to reproduce from supergravity, actually give you, because after all, you see, an integer is an integer. Any real number, no matter how close, is infinitely far from an integer. So unless you can really precisely add up everything exactly, you are not guaranteed to get an integer. You could get the leading answer to be very close, but the subleading answers could be very, very off. So in that sense, that's what I meant by this rigidity of string theory, that string theory is really ultraviolet rigid. You cannot tweak with some part of the theory, because then these integers will just go off. So this is what I'm going to describe tomorrow, that how to get this, how to go from Bekenstein-Hawking, which is way off compared to what the answer we want. Now you might think that, okay, see, 15 is already, it's pretty large area. I mean, pi times, okay, I mean, what I'm saying is that it's reasonably large that you might think that quantum corrections are negligible. But there is a logarithmic correction that we actually gets it pretty closer. But now our goal will be to whether we can really do the full answer and get the exactly the integer. So it turns out that roughly speaking, Z is like the chemical potential for Q dot P. And yeah, and tau is like the chemical potential for Q square. And in this problem, P square is said to be 2, Q square upon 2, which is an integer. So basically, as I told you, even though you have a black hole with 56 charges, because if you take type 2 string theory on a T6, you have all kinds of D brains. So you have basically 56 variety of brains. And some of them are electric, some of them are magnetic. So you have to specify all those charges. So you might think that you have to find the degeneracy as a function of each of these integers. But it turns out you can, first of all, these are the T-duality invariants. The T-duality invariants are Q square and P square. So there are 56 divided by 2 is how much? Okay, whatever is that number? 28. So 28 is the number of electric charges. So Q is a 28-dimensional vector. You take the square of it. It's some Lorentzian vector. So actually, you have to take the Lorentzian square, which is the T-duality invariant. And then you take P square and so on. Okay? So now, in this particular example, just to simplify things, I can... So therefore, in the end, it depends only on this q square p square minus q dot p. I'm actually going to some duality frame. So let's, but just to give you some understanding, so I can choose now p square to be something simple like 2. Then I'm left with basically 2 integers. So then, therefore, I need a partition function which has 2 chemical potentials corresponding to those 2 integers. And z and tau, like in our, in this problem, in the case of strict, we had 22.6 lattice. We had again 28 charges. But it depended only on q square. And that was one integer. So you require, in the heterotic problem, we require one chemical potential, which was tau. So that is our goal. Now, just before we switch, so I have now how many? 15 minutes, right? So in the next 15 minutes, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to complete what we started yesterday, just so that you have a definition of quantum entropy. So, but I want to emphasize one fact here, that C of delta have an alternating sign, right? It's a very trivial looking computation that we did, right? After all, these were just T4. It's a conformal field theory whose target space is T4. You have four bosons and four fermions. And it's some index that you're computing in that conformal field theory. Sorry. And they have an alternating sign, so D of delta is strictly positive. So this is a prediction from the infrared quantum gravity for black holes, which is borne out by the ultraviolet. So what do I mean by that? See, this would be very surprising for a field theorist or a number theorist. Because if you tell, give some modular form like this, theta 1 squared upon eta to the 6. If you give a generic modular form to a number theorist and ask what are the Fourier coefficients, there is no natural positivity property for a modular form. If you expand a modular form, its Fourier coefficient can be either positive or negative. They can be sometimes positive, sometimes negative. Similarly, if you gave a computation to calculate the ground states of some supersymmetric theory, then the index in general is can be positive or negative. There is no reason why the index has to be always positive. So it's a fact that if this conformal field theory has anything to do with a black hole, then it has to be the case that the Fourier coefficient come with this particular sign. And they do. So this you can take as a kind of a triumph of our reasoning. Now the question is that can the quantum gravity path integral really reproduce these non-trivial integers? Now this looks like a really difficult thing to do because an integer is an integer and a path integral is a continuous and analytic object. So this is actually, for me, this is one of the surprises which really should convince you that there is something right about string theory. That how can a path integral which is an analytic object, complex analytic object, I mean typically it's a complex number, generally it's a complex number, give an integer. Unless we were doing something right. I mean, generically, if you do a generic path integral, you get some random complex number. And what connects it is this beautiful formula of Hardy, Ramanujan, and Rademacher. This is basically what is called analytic number theory. Which allows you to connect numbers with analytic functions. And this is an, so here is the, for C of delta, there exists, thanks to these people, an exact formula. This is a highly convergent expansion. It's not an asymptotic expansion. It's an exact formula. There is some number here that is known. I mean, it's not some undetermined constant. That C of delta is an infinite sum over complex analytic functions, just regular Bessel functions, which are of this form. This is a Bessel function. If you remember your Bessel functions from electrodynamics, it's a variety of Bessel function. And it has a large Z expansion, which looks like that, Z minus 4 log Z plus C upon Z. And therefore, you can see that already if you take the logarithm of the first term in this expansion, sums all perturbative corrections in 1 upon Z to entropy. You could interpret this as being an area expansion of the kind that I was writing down. This is really area upon 4. Log of area plus something upon area plus and so on. So this is exactly the area expansion that I was talking about. So the fact that this counting numbers have this kind of exact expression allows you to make contact with the path integral because the path integral starts out by being an infinite, by a complex number. But this formula from analytic number theory tells you that that integer maybe we should represent as a sum over infinite terms, and each of these terms we can obtain from a path integral. And these infinite discrete sum, it will turn out, comes from some orbifold, some discrete sum that you have to do over the path integrals. So the path integrals has additional infinite number of saddle points, which you have to sum over. And when you do all that, you get, you are guaranteed to get an integer. So this is, it looks like something that we can try to do using the path integral. So Kc delta is the beast, which is called the generalized Clusterman sum. And this is what actually stopped us for, I mean, so we had results for this, for the Bessel function quite a while ago, a couple of years ago. But then there was really no way for us to see how in the world this Clusterman sum could arise from a supergravity path integral. But this is what the answer is telling you from the computation, from the counting, that this Kc is some, it's actually a deep, it has some deep number theory associated with it. This is called Clusterman sum. And these are basically, it's a product of phases. So there is a phase e to the 2 pi I d over c times delta. Delta, you remember, was our duality invariant. 2 pi I a over c, where d is relatively prime compared to c. So c is an integer. So we had some sum over c. So c is an integer, 1, 2, 3, and so on. D in this sum, for each c, you had a kc, which depended on delta. And that kc, in turn, is a sum over an integer d, d, which is relatively prime. That means d and c don't have any common factors. So d and c are relatively prime. And a, you can think of as a d inverse. So these are what, these are kind of what the mathematicians call finite fields. So A is D inverse in that AD is equal to 1 mod C. So for example, if C is equal to 5 and D is equal to 2, then C, A can be 3. Because 3 times 2 is 6. And 6 mod 5 is 1. So the inverse of 2 in this finite field is 3. Okay, so it's, it, A is an inverse of. So now everything is clear in this formula except for this matrix, which I'll tell you what it is. But basically, this is just some simple phase. This is another simple phase given, and you have to sum over all the d's. So this is d and this is d inverse. And there is a representation of the 2 by 2 gamma. It's a 2 by 2 representation. M inverse gamma is a particular 2 by 2, two-dimensional representation of SL2Z matrix for given A, B, C, D. So these are the same A, B, C, D's. So B is actually not important, it turns out. And so basically, given A, D, and C, this is the particular representation where M inverse of T is this and M inverse of S. So you know that SL2Z is generated by this matrix 1 minus 1, which is the S matrix, and the translation matrix, which is 1, 1. This is a different two-dimensional representation of these matrices. And given any gamma, which is of this form, you can, there is a continued fraction expansion of that integer. So basically, there is a number theory associated with it, and an algorithm that given any A, B, C, D, you write it in this form, use these forms of the T and S, and you multiply things together, and you will get some answer. And that is what should go into this formula. Okay? So our task is going to be reproduce this exact expression from doing a path integral of quantum gravity. Now that to you should seem like a really somebody who's really driven mad by but it turns out that using localization you can do it. I mean, if you had to do some random path integral, there was no hope that you could ever get something very precise like that. But using supersymmetry and localization, we will actually be able to do this path integral. Yeah, so the leading growth comes from the first Bessel function. These are all non-perturbative corrections. Huh? Okay, so this is a good point to explain to me, explain to you the general structure of this formula. So the general structure of this formula is of the form, so this integer that we are interested in, d of q, is therefore a sum over some Bessel function and times some Clusterman sum. But this actually is coming out to be the, it's a very specific pi square root of delta divided by
See? And I knew of z goes as e to the z minus 4 log z, etc. So we can see that c is equal to 1 sums all the perturbative expansions, all the perturbative corrections to Bekenstein-Hawking. Why? Because z is basically area upon 4, which is pi square root of delta. So it's clear that if I expanded this, I will receive all these corrections, 4 log z, etc. This sum of the power. But now you can see that c is equal to 2 is exponentially suppressed. Compared to the first one, right? Because it is the first term is going as e to the z, and the other terms are going e to the z upon c. So compared to the first term, these are exponentially suppressed. So these are non-perturbative corrections. So this formula already gives you a kind of a physical interpretation of what you should look for. That the leading formula, if you really take area very large, then of course you can drop these terms, all the higher C terms you can drop. And also, you can basically approximate it at very large Z. You can approximate this as I nu of pi square root of delta upon 1. And this you can further approximate as e to the pi square root of delta, which is just e to the area upon 4. But therefore, this formula contains all the subleading corrections in 1 upon area, as well as e to the minus areas, things which are suppressed by e to the minus area. So that's the, and the Clusterman sums become relevant only for the so even though just with the first term, can get the answer which is pretty close, unless you manage to unless you succeed in getting all the phases right, you cannot declare victory, because if the phases are even slightly wrong, then you will not get an integer. So we really have to, if you want to get an integer, you cannot fool around too much. I mean, you cannot fool around at all. You either get the integer or you don't get the integer. So you have to precisely get that integer, and the path integral of quantum gravity for this particular string compactification has to have all the ingredients in it to be able to give that integer. So that's what we're going to describe tomorrow. So I have how much time? 3 minutes?
Exactly done.
Okay. So maybe tomorrow, can I, okay, tomorrow if I can get 5 minutes extra. Okay, why don't I take 5 minutes now and 5 minutes tomorrow? No, I just want to tell you, so I think I have, I hope that I have set up this problem for you correctly, completely, that we have two sides of the problem, D of Q and W of Q. D of Q, we know how to calculate, and moreover, using some formulas of analytic number theory, we can represent it in a manner that we can interpret it physically. And the leading answer does look like having an interpretation. But now we require a precise definition of WQ to be able to, W of delta, W of Q. So basically now I just want to start out, maybe I will not complete it since I give. No, I mean, it may be better that if I take 10 minutes tomorrow, it might be better than 5 plus 5. What do you, okay. I'm just negotiating here, but okay. Why don't I more or less started doing this definition yesterday. So what I'll do is let me just complete the definition. I'll recapitulate tomorrow. So we basically started out by considering and we had the metric, and we said that we impose and that more or less fixed the form of the metric. I mean, so for example, the metric had to be, I mean, that completely fixes the form of the metric, for example, right? And then we had various gauge fields. They had to be equal to minus IEI. And we had various scalar fields, which had to take some constant values. This is what we got for the classical black hole. And this I explained to you that this has to be of this form, r minus 1 to be non-singular at the origin and so on. And so the basic idea is that this is the classical problem, but in quantum mechanics, we know that in holography, so in classical mechanics, classical context, what happens is that you fix the growing mode of the field at infinity, and then you solve its equations of motion, which is just some box acting on that field. And then there's some regularity condition fixes the other mode of the. But in general, quantum mechanically, what we're going to do is now, going to quantum mechanics is quantum field theory, the quantum, so this is classical. You simply elevate this to a path integral. You think of W of Q, we will define as a path integral of this Wilson line in this quantum field theory. The magnetic charges are included in this as the fluxes in some internal S2. So there is just some parameters of this theory. So this depends also on this magnetic charges secretly. But Qs appear explicitly here. And what you're instructed to do is to do a path integral of this Wilson line in the ADS2 background. But when you do a path integral, your metric is no longer going to be this, or your gauge fields are no longer going to be this, or even the scalar field is no longer going to be this, because generically they will perform very random quantum fluctuations. And what you want to do is include all of them. But in order to make the path integral well-defined, you have to specify the boundary conditions of those fields. So what we're going to do is that only asymptotically, as somebody asked the question, that impose asymptotic ADS2 boundary conditions. So for example, it's enough that the metric goes to roughly, for example, it goes to something like that, which looks like ADS2 at infinity. But it can, for example, we will consider things like that, you know, which differ from the asymptotic ADS, which look asymptotically ADS, but are a bit different if you go slightly inside. Similarly, this field can be a constant at infinity, but it can has a random quantum fluctuation inside. So we're going to use the classical geometry just to set the boundary conditions, the asymptotic boundary conditions on this path integral. So that's one thing. Secondly, we have to do, second thing is that we have to do a renormalization procedure. And that simply meant that we had to put a cutoff R naught to regulate the volume of the ADS2. And it'll turn out that this path integral, this is something that I will explain tomorrow, that this path integral will generically have a divergence of the kind e to the minus c, some 2 pi c R naught. So there will be a R0 dependent divergence, and which we can interpret because 2 pi R0 is the circle of the radius at infinity. So this you can interpret as some kind of a ground state energy of the boundary CFT, which you can shift. I mean, what is the ground state energy at infinity is the Hamiltonian of the CFT at infinity can be shifted to by that C, and such that the origin of that Hamiltonian is set to 0. So that ambiguity in choosing the origin of energy in the boundary theory is precisely responsible. So that's like what we are used to in holographic renormalization, that there are counter terms, that this is a local counter term in the boundary theory because it's just the vacuum energy, and which you can just remove. So you drop this. That divergent piece you drop. And then what you're left with is guaranteed to be finite, because in holographic renormalization, you're allowed to add local counter terms, local counter terms in the boundary theory, and that should render your answer finite. And here, the only divergence comes from this ambiguity in the shift of the vacuum energy. And then the third thing, that final thing was that the reason we had to insert this is required simply by the fact to make the variational problem for the Maxwell field well defined.
I have one question.
Yeah?
There was a 1 by C that you added in the metric.
This?
Okay.
Yeah, it's going to be that C. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Let me use this something A. But E naught, let's call this E naught. So naively you might have computed just the partition function, right? I mean, when you do ADS CFT, you compute the partition function and you compare it with the partition function. So why are we computing the insertion of Wilson line? That's just one final point I want to explain and then I will stop. Is that basically you have some, in two-dimensional gauge field, right? You have some two-dimensional gauge field, right, in ADS2. So suppose you have a Maxwell field in ADS2. Then you can go to the gauge where AR is 0, for example. And then you just have FR theta is equal to del R A theta. Now, if you do a variation of this to get the Maxwell equations, that the variation of this action is going to give you del R of del theta, del R of delta of A theta, right? Something is wrong. What is it? Yeah, the variation of this. Yeah, that's right. So del R of delta A theta times FR theta. And then typically what you do is integrate by parts to get the Maxwell equation, but that will leave you a boundary term because now your integral is going from 1 to R0. So this leaves behind a boundary term, which is FR theta del R del A theta plus the usual equation that you get, del R FR theta. So since this is an arbitrary variation, this must be 0, so that you get the equation of motion. But you're left with this term, so you cannot actually conclude that. But this is easy to fix. The way you fix it is that you add a term. Suppose you had added a term which is q times a in the boundary. Then the variation of that will give you delta of a theta, because in the boundary you only have a theta. So delta of a theta, so if you adjust your q, given a q, you can adjust your FR theta in such a way that this term gets cancelled. Okay, is that clear? So that Wilson line is required just to make the variational problem well-defined. So that's the natural thing to do. So given this, now our problem is completely well-stated, that we have a path integral to be done of a Wilson line inserted at infinity, which depends on the, and then this q you can identify with the charge of the black hole. So the way I stated it here, it's not clear immediately that the q is the charge of the black hole. But basically by looking at the fact that it's a flux coming from the sphere and the flux is conserved, you can identify that Q is there. So basically now my path integral is, and Q therefore are to be identified as the integers. So Qs are integers. The information about the integers is going through in this path integral. Right, after all, you want to get an integer out of a path integral. So there must be some integral information you have to give. So the fluxes are integral, and these charges are integral. That information you are putting in. And then the boundary condition, this term is required to make the variational problem well defined. And then the boundary conditions are set by the asymptotic ADS2 geometry. And then there is still a bit of a renormalization that you have to do, but which is not very serious in this case. You just have to eliminate a constant. And then your path integral is completely well defined. So that's the path integral that we want to do. So that is our W of Q. And we now have something to shoot for, that the W of Q somehow should have the same structure that we are finding from the boundary side. And but it's still it's quite surprising that a path integral will actually give you all these things precisely. And that's where localization actually helps you, that you can explicitly evaluate these things. Okay, so I think I'll stop here.